Hello everyone. So in the last lecture we defined a normal subgroup, and in today's lecture we will see a few examples and a few equivalent definitions for a normal subgroup. So let's quickly recap what is a normal subgroup. A subgroup H of a group G is called a normal subgroup if and only if every left coset of H is equal to corresponding right coset of H in G. So firstly, H has to be a subgroup of G, and then it must satisfy an extra condition that every left coset is equal to corresponding right coset. GH must be the same as HG, and this should be true for all elements of the group. So a normal subgroup is a special kind of a subgroup. Firstly, it has to be a subgroup, and then it has to satisfy this extra condition. And if H has to be, if H is a normal subgroup of G, then symbolically we write that this way. So as quick examples of normal subgroups for any group G, let us look at the trivial subgroup. Trivial subgroup is the subgroup containing only identity. So if I take trivial subgroup, then for this the left coset will be obtained by multiplying every element in the subgroup from the left with the element G. And since there is only one element in this set, it will contain the element G into E, which is singleton set containing G. Likewise, the set HG will be multiply every element in the subgroup H from the right with the element G, but this will also give us singleton G. And therefore, the left coset GH is the same as the right coset HG for all elements of the group. So, trivial subgroup is always a normal subgroup in any group. So, for any group, trivial subgroup will always be a normal subgroup. So, if I take H to be the trivial subgroup, then I have proved that it is a normal subgroup of G. On the other hand, let me take the improper subgroup H, which is the whole group G. This is called an improper subgroup. Now for this, because all elements lie inside the group, G, the left coset GG will be the same as G, right coset will also be the same as G. Everything is happening inside the group. So, this left coset and this right coset will have to be equal for all elements of the group. So, improper subgroup is also a normal subgroup of G. So, these are quick examples of normal subgroups for any group. For any group, trivial subgroup is normal and improper subgroup is also normal. So, we would like to focus on other normal subgroups. So firstly, while we are at the topic, these two are always going to be normal subgroups. Question is whether G has any other normal subgroup. If the answer is no, then G is called a simple group. So a simple group is one which does not have any proper, non-trivial, normal subgroups. So, in other words, if a group is simple, it will have only two normal subgroups, namely the trivial subgroup and the improper subgroup. It will not have a third subgroup which is normal in it. So, if a group has only two normal subgroups, the trivial subgroup and the improper subgroup, or if a group does not have any proper non-trivial normal subgroup, then it is said to be simple. And if you are looking for an example of a simple group, all you have to do is to take a group of prime order. Because if I take a group of prime order, I have proved as one of the corollaries of Lagrange's theorem that this group will have only two subgroups. Now, why should that really happen? In case you haven't seen that video, you have to use Lagrange's theorem. If H is a subgroup of a group, then order of the subgroup has to divide the order of the group. And if this order of the group is a prime number, the only numbers which will divide P are 1 and P. So if H is a subgroup of G and order of H is 1, it will have to be this. If order of H is P, it will have to be this. So if I take a group of order P, a prime number, then it has only two subgroups and these two are normal. Basically, it does not have a third subgroup and therefore it cannot have a third normal subgroup. There is no other subgroup and therefore there is no other normal subgroup. So every group of prime order is simple. So straightforward result. Every group of prime order is simple. So it would be interesting to try and find an example of a group which is not of prime order. It should be of composite order and it is simple. So hold that thought and after the lecture you can actually look for an example of a group which is of composite order and it is simple. So meanwhile, let's come back to the definition. So the definition says H is a normal subgroup of G if and only if every left coset is equal to corresponding right coset of H in G. Now this is basically, these are basically sets, but just like we have our pre-multiplication and post-multiplication by a particular element on both sides, the arithmetic also works in the case of sets. So that can be checked easily. So this means, let me post-multiply by G inverse. So I'll get G H G inverse equal to H G G inverse. The fact that this arithmetic also works for sets can be easily verified and I am leaving that as an exercise. So this is equal to HE and we have proved earlier that HE is the same as H. I have proved it for left cosets but I have also mentioned that the property works for right cosets as well. So I can now take this as an equivalent definition for a normal subgroup. H is a normal subgroup if and only if the set G, H, G inverse is the same as H and this should be true for all elements of the group. So this becomes an equivalent definition for a normal subgroup. Let us now obtain one more equivalent definition. So let me call that as theorem 1. Let H be a subgroup of a group G, then I will prove that H is a normal subgroup of G if and only if G H G inverse lies inside H for all G in capital G and for all elements H in capital H. So the situation is somewhat like this. Suppose this is my group G. This is a subgroup of G, then it's already assumed that H is a subgroup. Now if it so happens that if I take an element H inside H and I take an element G anywhere in the group, whether it is outside H or inside H, it should not matter. So wherever I take this element G in the group, it, even if it lies outside H, the product G H G inverse, G H G inverse should always lie inside H. So if this product always lies inside H, then we will prove that H becomes a normal subgroup. So again, it's an if and only if result. So let's break up the proof in two parts. So firstly, let us assume that H is a normal subgroup of G. Let H be a normal subgroup of G. I wish to prove that if I take any element in the group and any element in the subgroup, then this element G H, G inverse, has to lie inside H. So let G be any element of the group G, H be any element of capital H. Let me use the note that I gave just now. Namely that this is an equivalent definition for a normal subgroup. So we know that G capital H, G inverse should be the same as H. Now I must remind you all, we have come across this set before at the end of the last the lecture in the last chapter. So elements of this set have to look something like this. We'll talk more about this set a little later. So now look at this element G H, G inverse. Look at the element G H, G inverse. The center element is from the subgroup H. So this element looks like a product of three elements, where the first element is G, last element is G inverse, and the center element is coming from H. So it is clear that this element lies inside this set. But then this set is the same as H. So that means this element will also lie inside H. And this is going to be true no matter which element G I choose in capital G, H in capital H. So this element will always lie inside H. So one way the result is proved. Let's look at the converse. So conversely, suppose H is a subgroup of G such that G H, G inverse lies inside H for all G in capital G, for all H in capital H. Let me prove that that H becomes a normal subgroup of G. So I claim, as per the note that I gave before this theorem, it is enough to prove that G H G inverse is the same as H. So this is what I aim to prove, that this set should be the same as this. So I begin with any element in this set. So let X belong to, remember our standard technique, if we wish to prove that two sets are equal, we must show that each one is a subset of the other. So we start with an element on the left hand side. Now if I take any element in this set, it has to look like a product of three elements. First element should be G, last element should be G inverse, and this middle element can be anything so long as it belongs to capital H. So X will look like some G H G inverse, where this middle element comes from the subgroup H. But see, what is our assumption? Our assumption is this kind of an element will always lie inside H. So this element will always be inside H. That means X will be inside H, and therefore G H G inverse is a subset of H. So we have proved that this set is a subset of this. Now let's prove the reverse inclusion. So firstly, we note that this relation is true for all elements in the group. So this relation that I have established is true for all elements in the group. So in place of G, it is perfectly okay to replace it by any other element of the group. So if G is an element of G and G is a group, I know that G inverse is also going to be in G, and therefore I can replace G by G inverse, because this relation works for all elements of the group. So in particular, it will also now work for the element G inverse. So we simply replace G by G inverse and we get G inverse H inverse of G inverse is also a subset of H. And this G inverse inverse is G. So G inverse HG is a subset of H. And as I told you previously, for sets also that pre-multiplication, post-multiplication business actually works. So let us pre-multiply by G and post-multiply by G inverse. So I will get G inverse HG, G inverse subset of G, HG inverse. And we are almost through, because just like I said, you can pre-multiply, post-multiply. You can also use associative property between the elements that you get in this kind of a product. So this G, G inverse will give me E, H, E. Now E, H is H, and then again H, E is H. So from here I will get H is a subset of G, H, G inverse relation 2. So if we now look at, if we now put 1 and 2 together, we will get G, H, G inverse is the same as H, and this is true for all elements of G. Therefore, H will become a normal subgroup of G. Okay? So this is yet another equivalent definition of a normal subgroup. So far we have given three equivalent definitions. One was in terms of cosets. Firstly, H has to be a subgroup, and then something more. Now that something more can be given in terms of cosets. Namely, every left coset has to be equal to corresponding right coset, or as we gave in the note, this equation must be satisfied for all G in G. And thirdly, now we have proved an equivalent definition in terms of elements. For every element G in capital G, H in capital H, the element G, H, G inverse has to lie inside H. So if any one of these three conditions is satisfied, then H becomes a normal subgroup. In the next lecture, we will look at some more equivalent definitions of a normal subgroup. That's all for now. Thank you, folks.